blessed this morning. It's great to see you here, even though it's a wee bit drizzly and horrible. And welcome to everybody who's watching us at home. So we'll say together the prayer of preparation. Almighty God,
to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom the secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of the Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name. Through Christ our Lord. Amen.
God so loved the world that he gave his only Son, Jesus Christ, to save us from our sins, to be our advocate in heaven, and to bring us to eternal life. Let us confess our sins in penitence and faith, firmly resolved to keep God's commandments and to live in love and peace with all. Most merciful God,
our Lord Jesus Christ, we confess that we have sinned. Thought, word, and deed. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbours as ourselves. In your mercy, forgive what we have been. Help us to amend what we are, and correct what we shall be. That we may do justly, love mercy, and walk humbly with you, our Lord. Amen.
Almighty God, who forgives all who truly repent, have mercy upon you, pardon and deliver you from all your sins, confirm and strengthen you in all goodness, and keep you in life eternal. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Amen.
The Old Testament reading is to be found on page 230 in the Pew Bible. The reading is from Joshua 24, verses 1 and 2 and 11 to 18. Then Joshua gathered all the tribes of Israel to Shechem and summoned the elders, the heads, the judges, and the officers of Israel. And they presented themselves before God. And Joshua said to all the people, "Thus says the Lord, the God of Israel, long ago your ancestors, Terah and his sons Abraham and Nahor, lived beyond the Euphrates and served other gods. Now therefore revere the Lord and serve him in sincerity and in faithfulness. Put away the gods that your ancestors served beyond the river and in Egypt, and serve the Lord. Now, if you are unwilling to serve the Lord, choose this day whom you will serve, whether the gods your ancestors served in the region beyond the river, or the gods of the Amorites in whose land you are living. But as for me and my household, we will serve the Lord." Then the people answered, "Far be it from us that we should forsake the Lord to serve other gods. For it is the Lord our God who brought us and our ancestors up from the land of Egypt, out of the house of slavery, and who did those great signs in our sight. He protected us along the way that we went, and among all the peoples through whom we passed. And the Lord drove out before us all the peoples, the Amorites, who lived in the land. Therefore, we also will serve the Lord, for he is our God." This is the word of the Lord. The New Testament reading is on page 209 in the Pew Bible. The reading is from Ephesians chapter 6, verses 10 to 20. "Finally, be strong in the Lord and in the strength of his power. Put on the whole armour of God, so that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. For our struggle is not against enemies of blood and flesh, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the cosmic powers of this present darkness, against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly places. Therefore, take up the whole armour of God, so that you may be able to withstand on that evil day, and having done everything, to stand firm. Stand therefore, and fasten the belt of truth around your waist, and put on the breastplate of righteousness. As shoes for your feet, put on whatever will make you ready to proclaim the gospel of peace. With all of these, take the shield of faith, with which you will be able to quench all the flaming arrows of the evil one. Take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. Pray in the Spirit at all times, in every prayer and supplication. To that end, keep alert and always persevere in supplication for all the saints. Pray also for me, so that when I speak, a message may be given to me to make known with boldness the mystery of the gospel, for which I am an ambassador in chains. Pray that I may declare it boldly as I must speak. This is the word of the Lord.
Will you please stand for our gospel reading?
Christ according to John.
Glory to you.
Jesus said to the crowd, "Those who eat my flesh and drink my blood abide in me, and I in them. Just as the living Father sent me, and I live because of the Father, so whoever eats me will live because of me. This is the bread that came down from heaven, not like that which your ancestors ate and have died. But the one that eats this bread will live forever." He said these things while he was teaching in the synagogue at Capernaum. When many of his disciples heard it, they said, "This teaching is difficult. Who can accept it?" But Jesus, being aware that his disciples were complaining about it, said to them, "Does this offend you? Then what if you were to see the Son of Man ascending to where he was before? It is the Spirit that gives life, the flesh is useless. The words that I have spoken to you are spirit and life. But among you there are some who do not believe." For Jesus knew from the first who were the ones that did not believe and who was the one that betrayed him. And he said, "For this reason I have told you that no one can come to me unless it is granted by the Father." Because of this, many of his disciples turned back and no longer went about with him. So Jesus asked the 12, "Do you also wish to go away?" Simon Peter answered him, "Lord, to whom can we go? You have the words of eternal life. We have come to believe and know that you are the Holy One of God." This is the Gospel of the Lord. Jesus tells us that we will abide in him and he in us. So it's a two-way thing. He invites us to make him our abode, and that certainly sounds good. But he also expects to abide in us. What kind of abode are we able to provide for him? He doesn't mind that we aren't perfect, doesn't expect it. He enters graciously into our mess, our brokenness, glad to be invited in and asked to abide. And he'll stay with us all the time. Jesus doesn't find fault behave now that he's involved. We will have to make sacrifices and live and act in ways that we wouldn't necessarily have left to our own devices. To follow Jesus has always been a demanding choice. For all his humility, he certainly isn't meek and mild. He's bold, strong and outspoken, daring and countercultural, challenging injustice, standing up for the oppressed and the unloved, putting others before himself. And when he abides in us, he asks the same of us as his disciples. So the metaphor he uses of eating his flesh and drinking his blood begins to make sense. The image it evokes goes against the familiar, the comfortable, and the conventional. It's not an easy concept for us to stomach with our respectable lifestyles. But while Jesus obviously isn't talking about cannibalism, he was talking about something which is hard to swallow. The reality of the part that we played in his sacrifice of his own flesh and blood on the cross. It was an ordeal he was prepared to endure simply out of love for us, who were created in God's image, but who had come so far down the wrong path that we couldn't find our way back. But God's purpose has always been to draw all people to himself. And because of that, he came into the world and died for us, and rose again in order to reconcile and restore our relationship with him. Our salvation was freely and willingly given to us at great cost to God's only beloved Son. That is the precious flesh and blood that we are asked to consume, to take into ourselves and allow to abide in us. God's selfless love, the source of our redemption. Someone once said that they thought the children in junior church would be frightened by the crucifix on the wall in the Nichols room. But that doesn't seem to be the case. It's such a familiar image which we see all over the place in church, and it's the image that's at the centre of our faith. So it's perhaps right that we encounter it in the course of everyday life. It's a depiction which has been considerably toned down compared with the reality. Jesus would have been naked and his body would have been much more bloody and bruised and bashed than any of the images that we've ever seen. But at least we haven't hidden the crucifixion away altogether. To do so, we need to risk modifying our religion into one that simply makes us feel good. To avert our eyes from the crucifixion is to shrink from the magnitude of the sacrifice that Christ made for us. Back in the reading from St. John's Gospel, that's what Jesus is trying to convey to the people. To follow him will be hard. So far, they've been enjoying all the drama and excitement of the miracles, and they like following a charismatic and captivating preacher. But now, when he begins to talk about flesh and blood and self-sacrifice, they start to drift off. Jesus is saddened, but not surprised. He turns to his disciples and asks them if they're going to leave him too. We wouldn't blame them if they did. But Peter knows that Jesus alone holds the keys to the kingdom of heaven. Jesus has told us that to eat his flesh and drink his blood is the only way to eternal life. And he's made it easy for us. He's given us the Eucharist to remind us. Here he feeds us with himself to nourish and sustain us. This is a precious meal. Heavenly food, uniting us as a family and as friends, as the body of Christ, all equally loved as we come to the Lord's table. At the Eucharist, Jesus invites us to reflect again on our part in his sacrifice, to repent afresh and accept God's infinite love and forgiveness. We live here as one body, inseparable from Christ and from one another. Jesus renews his invitation to us to abide in him, as he abides in us, and we decide whether to accept or to walk away. But as Peter said, Lord, to whom can we go? You have the words of eternal life.
stand to affirm our we believe in one Lord,
the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified on the Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again, according to the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven. And he's seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom shall have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit,
the Lord,
the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and Apostolic Church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Let us bring ourselves before our Lord as Julie leads us in our intercessions. Let us pray.
Lord, we ask, to whom else could we go? You alone have the words of eternal life. We come to you now and lay before you the worries and concerns that are on our hearts. In a moment of stillness, we ask that we may feel your presence with us, all to guide our thoughts and prayers. Lord, in your mercy. Lord, we pray for those whose faith is being challenged or undermined by inner doubts or outside influences. We pray for all those who build up our faith and all who strive to proclaim the gospel in language that people understand. We give thanks for the ministry team here in St. Leonard's, for Matt, for Viv, for Maggie, Jackie and Hugh, for their encouragement, support and love in sharing your word and leading us by example in faith. We think of the Methodist Church movement today, especially Lexden Methodist Church, for their leaders and all who worship there. We pray for all who live in the parish of St. Leonard's, and especially today for all those living in Magazine Farmway, Sussex Road, Hubert Road, and Stirling Close. And we think of Lexden Primary School, all those who work there supporting the children in their growth and learning, and for the children themselves, especially those preparing to start there in September. Lord, in your mercy.
Yeah.
Lord, we pray for our torn and fragmented world, wrestling to equate the deep yearning for peace with the instinctive urge for gratification and power. Thinking at this time especially of the people of Afghanistan, giving thanks for all those who have laid down their lives in an effort to bring about peace there. And we earnestly pray that there will be no more lives lost. showed us how to forgive and be forgiven. We give thanks for our St. Leonard's family, rejoicing that we are beginning to come together once again in worship and fellowship. And we especially think of all those who have not felt able to physically join us here in this building, and yet are very much part of our family. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
Lord, we pray for all who are marginalised, scorned or rejected, those isolated through illness or imprisonment, those who will seek a place of safety in our country, especially here in Colchester. Help us to treat them with respect and love, and support them in the way you would have us do. We take a moment now to think of all those named in our news sheet who have asked for our prayers. Nick and Margaret Leamy, Pat Marsh, Pam Happily, Francis Dowson and Joan Collis. For Mary Green, Ashley Cameron, Mandy and Paul Elms, Jill Farley, Jan Buckley, Tony Gurney, Shirley Everett, Stella Llewellyn, Doreen Mays, Betty Lies, Sheila Cook, Carol Durant, Joan Smith, Graham Clayton, Tim Knight, Holly Donovan, Tony Rose, Margaret and Owen Shepherd, Jasmine, Kathy Messenger, Sister Helen Julian, Wynn Kenway, Frieda and Ernest Jenkins, Jean Armstrong, John Brown, John Barker, Hilary Goodyear, Ellen Wally, Pam Happily, Florence Wheat, Erin Sagar, Angus, Chris, Maureen, Rosemary, Doug Brown. And in a moment of quietness, we think of all who we know who are in need of your love at this time. We ask, Lord, that your love will enfold all for whom we pray. Your peace will calm and refresh them, and your healing will bring them tranquility and hope. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
Lord, we pray for those approaching death, that through our prayers they may know that they are accompanied with love on that journey. And we pray for all who have died recently, including Peter Thomas, Mary Hodge, Richard Elms, Jenny Mortimer, and John Beaton, and any known to us and to you, Lord. And we ask that they may come to know the full joy in heaven. We call to mind those whose anniversaries fall at this time. And Lord, we ask that you be with the family and friends of all who mourn, that their loved ones parting, they may rejoice in the love they share together and be strengthened by your love. Lord, in your mercy.
Amen.
Lord, we thank you for making yourself known to us, both in our daily living and here this morning in the breaking and sharing of bread. We ask that we may all be sustained by your word, body and spirit, during the coming week to do your will. Rejoicing in the fellowship of St. Leonard and all your saints, we commend ourselves and all people to your unfailing love. Merciful Father,
accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ.
are one body. You are called to his peace. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
Let's offer one another a sign of peace.
Together. Gracious God, accept these gifts and with them our lives to be used in your service through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Oh,
to us the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ, who, in the same night that he was betrayed, took bread and gave you thanks. He broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." He took the cup and gave you thanks. He gave it to them, saying, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in remembrance of me."
Great is the mystery of faith.
Send the Holy Spirit on your people and gather into one your kingdom all who share this one bread and this one cup, so that we, in the company of St. Leonard and all the saints, may praise and glorify you forever, through Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
By him, and with him, and in you, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory be yours, Almighty Father, forever and ever. Break this bread to share in the body of Christ.
Thank you.
two notices this morning. First of all, we had a wonderful morning yesterday when people bought their boxes for the Children's Society to be opened. There's no amount to declare a present. And that's because I think Julie's waiting for a few more boxes to come in. So if you could let her have them as soon as possible, then we'll be able to announce the amazing amount, I'm sure, that we've managed to collect for the Children's Society, whose needs are greater than ever. Jackie today is at All Saints, and on Friday at 3:30, there's a Thanksgiving service for Hilary Cowie, if any of you would like to come along to celebrate her life. And a message from Andrew Leonard-Jones, who is in conjunction with CAP, is holding a big bike revival. This sounds really exciting. And these are sessions for CAP in September. And he's looking for two or three volunteers who might like to